Hello, my name is Gil Benduff, CEO of TotalPhase. I'm glad you're able to join us for this introductory video on the A2B Bus Monitor application. Please note, A2B, also known as Automotive Audio Bus, is a registered trademark of Analog Devices. The A2B Bus Monitor application runs on our Primera serial platform, shown here. In this slide, you can see the two major components that will be needed to give you thorough analysis of your A2B bus. First on the right is the Primera serial platform. The Primera serial platform interfaces with your computer via either Ethernet or micro USB and is connected to the A2B adapter board via the included 34-pin to 34-pin header cable. The A2B adapter board sits between the master and first slave on your bus, giving it full access to all data between the master and all the slaves. Now, let's spend one brief moment reviewing the A2B architecture. A2B is transmitted in superframes. Each A2B superframe has both a downstream and upstream component. Each portion of that superframe contains a sync control frame and then data, and then a sync response frame and then data. Slaves have the ability to interrupt to get the master's attention, and in the data portion of an A2B superframe, you could find I2C, I2S for interrupt data. The number of data slots is configurable, generally TDM16 or TDM32. In the case of the bus monitor, the first two data slots are always reserved for captured control data. That means the rest of the slots, 14 if you're using TDM16 or 30 if you're using TDM32, are reserved for audio. Now that we've discussed the basic structure of an A2B superframe, let's go look at a more practical situation, debugging an automotive audio bus. Typically, the master, which is the head unit in a car, starts the communication process by setting up all the other nodes on the bus. This process is called discovery, and all those values are stored in registers. We easily expose those values to you in our node topology view. We'll show that to you live in just a few moments. Our bus monitor view is designed to let you track and visualize the discovery process, but also provide a real-time history to you as things occur on the bus. Once everything's been set up, the next thing that's going to happen is you'll be able to hear sound. We give you the ability to isolate individual channels, both upstream and downstream, as well as visualize those channels. You can hear things or see things as they occur in either direction, and you can also export the sound for analysis in more specific tools. One last step before the live demo. Let's show you how you would hook the A2B bus monitor into your system. It's pretty simple. On this slide, you've got a master and a slave, and then one other slave daisy chained to the first slave. Now you can easily see the Primera and the A2B bus monitor adapter board. Finally, what you can see is that you insert the A2B adapter board between the master and the first slave. That gives us total visibility to all communication on the bus. What you're looking at now is the bus data view within our A2B bus monitor application. Before we go any further in the demonstration, I'd like to show you one key localization feature. Although I'm doing this video in English, the A2B bus monitor application is available in Japanese, Korean, English, French, German, traditional Chinese, and simplified Chinese. The first thing I'm going to do is simply start the capture. Once the capture is started, as soon as traffic flows on the bus, it will start to immediately flash on the screen. What we can see here is it scrolling by. Let's take a look at the data as it comes through. What we can see now on the screen is we have a timestamp, a frame number, the direction, are there any flags, what node was involved, was it a read-write, what was the address and the data, was there an I2C command contained, was there an interrupt, and finally, is there a translation or a decoding available for the data. Let's take a look at this in a little bit more detail. So the first thing to note is we're still capturing data, and you can always see what's going on by scrolling. Now what I'm going to go ahead and do is, while we're still in the live mode, do just a little bit of filtering to show you a few extra features that are very convenient. First, let's say we were only interested in transactions that occurred downstream. I could check the downstream box and apply a filter. The capture is still going on. We haven't thrown anything away, but now we're only seeing downstream data. I could, of course, do the same thing with upstream and downstream, or I can start to look for certain specific flags. Let's say I wanted to find a B flag, which is for broadcast. I can apply the filter, and just that quickly, we can see all the broadcast transactions. I can select the transaction of interest, and I can unapply the filter. What's really powerful in this application is you're able to go ahead and maintain your place to see what happened immediately before and immediately after the filter that you just set. Similarly, I can go ahead and look for any I2C commands. Let's do that very quickly. What we can see is a series of I2C commands, and we can see what those I2C commands were. Let's do a little bit more interesting work. What if we were only interested in seeing particular addresses? Well, we could go ahead and enter those address values just separated by a space. So in this example, I'm going to go ahead and select for anything that has an address of 01 and 02. So in this particular case, I selected for anything that has an address of 01 and 02. Notice, because we removed the node filter, both nodes are now visible. It's a pretty powerful technique to go ahead and let you visualize anything that's going on the bus. Let's take a look at this text field very quickly. What you can see here is, if that value is populating a register, it'll give you the name of that register. That's probably a pretty good time for us to segue directly into the node topology view. To access it, click on the hamburger menu and select node topology. Now what you'll see is there were two nodes on the bus that I was working with. If I click on node 0, I can see the names of all the registers for those particular nodes. In this case, let's say that I wanted to go ahead and take a look at the vendor register. I could click on filter node and address. That'll go ahead and take me back to the bus monitor view, and it'll show me the whole history for that particular register. What I'm seeing on the node topology view is the last value for that particular register. Let's take a look now. What we see is there's been one value, and that data value was 0x00. And what you can see is we automatically populated node 0 and address 2. You can always select it to keep your place and then unapply. And again, that lets you see exactly what happened in the order that the transaction actually occurred, including a timestamp. Pretty powerful. Now remember, we still have a filter on here. I could go ahead and delete the filter and apply that as well. And then what we'll do is we'll have our place held the same way. Let's go back to that node topology view one more time. And let's see if we can find something a little bit more interesting. I'm going to go in node 1, and I'm going to go ahead and take a look at this one, which is called chip. This is the master communicating. I'm going to click on filter node and address. And what we see here is we have the whole history of everything that occurred for node 1, address 0. What's really powerful about this particular approach is it lets you go ahead and see the complete history of an individual register. What if there were a problem and you had to now isolate to find out what is the current set of register values and how did I get here? It's pretty straightforward. First of all, if you stop the capture at this point, the export buttons are available. In the bus monitor view, you can always export. It'll give you a CSV file, and from that CSV file, you can see the total history of the view that you were just looking at. In this particular case, we're seeing everything that was associated with node 1 and address 0. Let's quickly go back, though, and take a look at what happens when we do that same export process in the node topology view. Again, we click the export button on this particular tab, and we open it, and what we find is we now have a view that tells you here were all the register values at that exact point in time. It's a pretty handy way to go ahead and understand what happened during that setup process. Now, of course, once all the nodes have been set up and the system is functioning, there should be sound. Let's go take a look at how you would hear that sound. I'm going to now click on the audio channel view. What you can see, even before I enable any sound, is we've got activity on downstream channels 0, 1, 2, and 3, as well as upstream channels 0, 1, 2, and 3. If you want to hear sound and see a visualization in either amplitude or frequency, all you need to do is check the particular stream that you want to see activity on. As we hear the music play now, we can go ahead and see the amplitude. We can click on the spectrum tab to go ahead and see the frequency. You can add multiple channels for more activity, And similarly, you can go ahead and eliminate channels. We still show you what the activity levels are, even when no sound is being listened to. That just gives you an idea if a particular channel is working correctly or not. Let's say you need to capture the last few seconds of sound. What would you do? It's really pretty easy. All you have to do is stop capture, and instantly a save button appears. When you click on the save button, you're going to have a WAV file which contains just the filtered sound that you were listening to. That's perfect for you to import into another tool, such as an Audio Precision AP525. We hope you enjoyed this demonstration video. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact us at totalphase.com.